For months, my valiant and totally reasonable goal of gaming on a NAS using an external graphics card has eluded me. But a new contender promises to fulfill the prophecy. But first, speaking of computers, if you want to learn more about them than just Celeron plus fast graphics card equals bad, ha hee ha hee ha, then today's video sponsor, Brilliant.org, is the app for you. I've been enjoying their How Large Language Models Work course, which starts off by teaching you how to identify AI-generated content.
Nice.
Congratulations, you're now prepared for the AI apocalypse. You can try any of the thousands of lessons Brilliant has to offer, free for 30 days. Just visit the link brilliant.org/David or click the link below, and the first 200 of you will get 20% off of Brilliant's annual premium subscription. Now, according to Zztor, this NAS definitely supports GPUs being plugged into it, and they would know because, well, they made it.
Whoa, that's a lot of accessories. So we get two Cat5e cables, and then you get a bunch of drive screws and a little bracket that you can use for cable routing the power supply cable. That's a nice addition. And then we get quite a beefy 90 watt power brick and a cable for said power brick. And that's it.
Okay. This is the ASUSTOR AS6704T, and it looks like a network-attached storage with its four drive bays on the front. Insightful. And then on the back, we've got this huge fan to cool all of the hard drives inside, and we've got dual 2.5 gigabit Ethernet with one USB 3 port, which will be enough. We can use a dongle, and then the HDMI port and power.
Now, this HDMI port is A, rare, and B, very important for our use case of gaming on the NAS, because it lets us plug a monitor into it and install an operating system other than the NAS operating system on it that's just designed to store your pirated movies and highly embarrassing photos of you as a teenager on.
We've got like a little screen on the front that we can control with these buttons so that we don't need a monitor to operate it for said blackmail picture storage.
Now, this new NAS for our second attempt of GPU plugging into NAS action, that was very kindly sent over by ASUSTOR, by the way, gets a healthy spec bump. The previous one had a lowly Celeron J4105 in it, whereas this has the much more powerful Celeron N5105, which is like a slightly better version of the same one. But it does have a better iGPU in it, which means we'll probably get better gaming performance just straight out of the box from this NAS, which I think we should try now. So let's install Windows on it and see what kind of oomph we've got with this one.
Oh, this poor little bastard has no idea what terrible things are about to befall it. But let's see, Now, to convert the NAS from a powerful piece of network storage to a terrible little computer, I just dropped an SSD in, spent an embarrassing amount of time trying to get into the BIOS by hitting escape.
Hey! They just arbitrarily changed the button from escape to F2 between the two generations. Very nice.
But what I found in the BIOS more than made up for the betrayal.
Oh, you can turn resize bar on. That's a very good sign.
Then all I had to do was update the boot priorities, and I was ready to defile the NAS with Windows.
Ooh, now say what you will about this generous frame rate. This is 1080p gaming on a NAS. It's kind of like going on an Arctic expedition with a 90-year-old. It's not really its comfort zone, you know? And it's a very smooth 12 frames per second. Interestingly, as is often the case with these Celerons, the CPU is bottlenecking its own iGPU, which seems to happen quite a lot on this channel. But hopefully, if we add some more RAM into the system than the 4 gigs that we have now, if we can do that, it should give us a bit more CPU headroom for when we drop in the big boy graphics card. Oh, that comes off nice and easily. Oh, that's pretty cool. On the top here, we've got this little daughter board with space for four M.2 drives on top of the four 3.5mm drives. Hopefully, it's not too annoying for us to get access to the RAM. Oh, I see. So I think you just lift that up and then you can add another stick of RAM. Oh, and aside from the one RAM slot, I think it's going to be pretty easy to use the M.2 slots and an adapter to add a graphics card to this system. But before we tear it down more and have a look at these options, let's just drop in some more RAM and see how much of a performance difference that makes. Adding an 8GB stick has made a pretty big difference to the performance. It's not running at 24 frames per second yet, but it's getting closer. And currently, it seems like the iGPU and the CPU are pretty balanced in terms of bottlenecking situation. But yeah, look at that. You can kind of play GTA 5 at 1080p on a NAS if you have low enough standards, you know? I'm curious. I wonder if we can play like Crysis on it. At 1080p low settings, that is surprisingly good. Back when Crysis came out, people would sell off their grandchildren to get this kind of gaming experience in this game. And now it's running on a NAS. And as is always the case, Half-Life 2 is playable. Yay, very good. So yeah, just because your PC has the specs of a NAS, doesn't mean you can't have some good gaming action happening on it. And now that we've established that, it's time to drown the little NAS in more graphics card than it could ever have imagined. Now, before we plug a graphics card into it, I'm gonna disassemble it more than I need to because I can't help but break every piece of tech that I interact with. Yeah, so there's our little daughter board for a whole bunch of M.2 expansion. Next, I think we're gonna remove this back panel. Oh, that's where the rest of the screws were hiding. And then that just pops off. Oh, that's a cool looking interior. There's quite a lot going on in here. We've got the bit of I/O that's connected to what I guess we can call the main motherboard. And then this daughter board connects the storage to the main motherboard via a 4X PCIe slot. But I think now that we have it open like this, we can turn it around and we should be able to get this main board out. Okay. Oh, would you look at that? The 4GB actually isn't soldered down. It's just here. I'm gonna remove this and replace it with another 8GB stick. And here is our main board with the two 4X PCIe slots for connecting the two banks of storage to it, or graphics card. And under this tiny little heatsink is our Celeron, which I don't think is quite enough for gaming considering the mild heat stroke the CPU gets. Oh, I don't like this. Why do I always insist on doing this to myself? Oh, there we go. That's why, because it always looks cool under the thing. Whoa, this thing is so modular. Even the LCD with the little buttons is its own replaceable little daughter board. And this is the board for a couple more buttons and the front USB 3.2. So I think this is the kind of thing that theoretically is very repairable. With that itch scratched, I reassembled the system and went to grab the graphics card for this dumb experiment. And obviously we have to use the Waifu Yesten RX 7800 XT. Now, in order to get this behemoth working with the little NAS, we have to use our trusty M.2 to PCI Express adapter kit. Now, as far as I remember it, this is the one of the 18 that I bought that actually worked. Now, the idea is pretty simple. You just plug this end into an M.2 slot, you plug your graphics card into this end with a little bit of supplemental power, and you're off to the races. Let's see if it turns out that simple this time. Just like that, our waifu is nestled in blue tentacles ready to go. And I'm real excited to see if this works because this is the culmination of like 4 months of trying various configurations. Wow. I mean, that's a good sign. Things are spinning. Lights are going on. Whoa. This may legitimately be the first time in like 500 videos that I just plugged a thing in and it worked the way I wanted it to. Maybe I'm celebrating too soon.
I was celebrating too soon, because the driver install, when it finished, prompted the system to restart. And once it switched off, it just didn't post again.
I think the driver install corrupted the Windows. Because if you click on Windows Disk Manager or whatever, look.
I just had to tempt fate, didn't I? I couldn't wait for it to actually work before saying anything. Infuriatingly long story short, when I reassembled the system, I put the SSD back in the second slot, which on first boot, it didn't seem to mind. But after the restart, it suddenly was too good for the second slot for some reason. And when I moved the SSD back into the first slot, it booted. Again, for some reason.
Oh, thank Laude, that fixed it. We're using the graphics card now and we're posting back into Windows. This is a fresh install though, so I do need to reset everything up, which kinda sucks, but you know, it's better than nothing.
And it even survived the driver install restart, which meant we were ready to game.
It's finally happening. A waifu graphics card and NAS operating in perfect symbiosis. This is some real cutting edge GPU bottleneck cocking about. Wait a minute, why is it running more weirdly than it was with just the iGPU? But wait a minute, even with most of this stuff loading in, this is quite a good gaming experience.
I just crashed into a thing that I can't see. In fact, this is the worst I think I've seen this happen. Where, like, the game just doesn't load. Oh, it's so bad. The thing is, it's kind of weird, because normally when this happens, it's paired with a really low frame rate. But we're actually getting where, like, none of the game is rendering with a high frame rate.
Now, with Battlefield 5, after I've found somewhere to spawn, everything's rendering. We can see the game, things are happening. But at 1080p medium settings, we're sitting around 40 frames per second when we're lucky. This is an RX 6800 XT we're using here. I'm pretty sure this is not the correct amount of frame rates we're expecting from this graphics card. And another thing is you can see that we very much don't have a consistent frame time happening. It's all over the place, and you can really feel that in the game. This is a pretty bad feeling 40-ish frames per second.
However, when I finished playing Battlefield 5, something bad happened. While I was waiting for Cyberpunk to download its fifth 10-gig patch of the week, the system shut down, and it never turned on again. I don't know what's wrong with it or what happened, I just can't get it to post again. So we may have been able to game on it with a graphics card for a brief, beautiful moment, but I'm pretty sure that it killed it. Which brings me to the end of another video ending in destruction. Thank you very much for watching, and until the next one, bye-bye.